Niels.
Thanks. So thank you, Martin. So hi, everyone. Welcome to this talk. I'm going to talk about web security and hopefully answer the question, is it maybe broken by default? Most of this presentation is based on stuff that was presented at ObjectEU in Rome. I'm not sure if some of you have attended. I doubt it will be. Maybe those two, but the others, okay. There were pretty awesome talks given about web security in the current state of a lot of standards. And based on that, I defined a good topic to cover. So first, let me quickly. Oh, I need to go one. Okay, so I need to stand this up. Like this? No. And the nice thing, it's all being recorded, right? So we can always look at that. Okay, cool. So first, a brief introduction. So I'm Niels Tanis. I work as a security researcher for Veracode. Joined Veracode in 2015 as a consultant, security consultant. Helped out developers doing a better job, but that's also my background. I've done 12 years of .NET software development, pen testing, and security consulting. If you want to talk about Veracode, meet me after the session. Let's define a problem scope, or let's define at least the area of stuff that we need to talk about today. So what is the problem with web security? I think if you see the current technology stacks and the way that web applications are being developed, the complexity increases, and it increases in a big way, right? From technology perspective. The other thing is what will be done for you if you use a specific web stack. If you develop, let's say, on .NET, like what will be done for you, let's say, for encoding to make sure that you do a good job against cross-site scripting? What do you need to do for taking care of request forgeries, right? What are the proper stuff or the proper steps that you need to take in order to make sure that you utilize the framework in the best way possible, right? It's not always that transparent. And if we have everything in place, if we have done our coding right, because that's the other aspect, right? We need to make sure that we do proper development skills, that we not create dynamic queries, that we at least are doing input validation, sanitized data before we use it, right? Those are all like best practices for development. There's still one piece in the whole chain that will remain in place and which will cause a lot of problems, and that's the web browser. Some even say that it's broken by default and there's no way that we can fix it, because that's just how the internet works, how the browsers are being built, and vendors most of the time have no interest in changing it. At least it was being said like a couple of years ago. Because if they change it, they will break the internet, right? It's the behavior of the browser that's causing the problem. And therefore, we need to find out different ways in order to fix it. Another thing was a secure browser initiative was started. A browser was created that's supposed to be secure, but it did not work out nicely, right? So from that perspective, if we put everything in place, are we really that lost? And is everything really broken by default? And getting back to ObjectEU, I think there are pretty good standards being created right now by a lot of guys who work for Chrome, who work for Firefox, Mozilla, that will do a good job for us. So that will at least allow us to create more mitigating controls inside your browser and use them in the best way possible. So I'm going to talk you through about a couple of standards and a couple of things. I will give you a brief introduction of what it is. Maybe you've already heard about it, but at the end it will be a full story. So let's move forward. First of all, TLS, so the encrypted website. I think it's hard to imagine that nowadays websites will be deployed without any encryption at all, right? I think it should definitely not be done, because it will cost you too much, because Let's Crypt is an initiative that will give free certificates for everybody. And they also focus a lot on automation. So it should be an easy trick for you to just get their client, install it on your web server, deploy a certificate with a proper configuration on your web server, and use it. And that's all being done, right? DevOps and the way that we are developing differently, we want to continuously deploy in a quicker fashion, and we want to make sure that it all streamlined. And therefore, we need to just automate it and become really good at it. And that's one of the goals. If you also take a look at what the browsers will do, and Chrome is a nice example of it, they will just show that a non-TLS site will be insecure, and it will be visual to the end user. Like, hey, this is not good. You need to make sure that this is an encrypted channel if you talk to me. So on top of that, if we've got TLS, there are a couple of other standards that are pretty good on helping us out. And this is a lot of information in one slide, but let me briefly explain to you. So there is a header, which they call strict transport security. And what it means is that once the web server is being configured to talk to you in an encrypted way, if people first go to you in plain text, they will be redirected to the encrypted channel, right? So that's usually how it works. So you type in the address without the S at the end, without HTTPS. You will get the regular website. They will forward you to the more secure version because that's the thing that you need to use. What will happen then, of course, after that you will be on an encrypted channel, it will be good. But there is a window of opportunity for somebody to do bad things at the first moment when you go plain text to that first website and you end up being on an encrypted channel. And this header needs to, or will tell the browser that it's only allowed for a specific domain to be contacted over TLS, right? And that's exactly what strict transport security does. It has some attributes that has to do with the max age that it will keep that in place, and it can also include subdomains. But it's a countermeasure that will, as soon as somebody types in a plain text address, it will, or like a plain text communication channel for your website, the browser will not send out that request. It will immediately put you on an encrypted channel before that request even leaves the browser, which is good. There's also preload list which you can put your website in. They can publish it, so there's no need for that first request because that can still cause problems. These types of headers will be delivered to you the first time when you get to that website, and that of course also still has a marginal risk tied to that somebody has the opportunity to do that or become man in the middle and intercept your traffic, right? That's the goal. So I think this is good, right? So you've got TLS, you will do this hopefully and force users to always communicate with you on a secure channel. And the second thing, and this is a topic that has been pretty much discussed, like is it good, is it bad, should we do it, should we not do it? But based on certificates, of course, we do public key encryption, right? So there's a private key in the server, and there's a public key that will be given to the party that will consume the data. And with public key pinning, what you will do is you will make sure that you tell your end users that if somebody communicates with this web server, he will get a public key which meets this signature, right? So it's a piece of data that defines the public key information of the certificate, which is a hash. And if that will not match, then there is the potential of a rogue certificate being used, right? And nowadays, like the whole system itself, it happens, right? CAs are being compromised, and they will have certificates being issued for websites that are not redirected to the owner, right? So Komodo had some issues, Stock SSL had some issues lately. So I think it's good to do public key pinning in a way that you will reduce the risk of any rogue certificate being used. There are still a lot of other aspects you need to pay attention to. So, as I mentioned, let's briefly go over what it is and how it works. From the certificate, there will be a base64 encoded piece of information, and that's a hash. You will see that later on in one of the headers. I will show. And you need to do pinning at least at one of the following three levels, right? And you see at the right-hand side, you see a certificate chain, and there's a root at the top. There's an intermediate, which is the Let Script Authority, and below there's the Leave Certificate, which is like the website certificate that belongs to me. You can choose to pin at each level. It will mean that if somebody gets the website, the web browser will validate it, and it will validate the chain, and once it meets one of the pins that have been set, so let's say, in my case, I will pin it on the intermediate certificate, it will validate it, it will come across that single pin, and it will say, okay, this is good. I trust, or at least the certificate is part of the chain that should be trusted for this website, so let's move on. Big issue with this is that you need to make sure that you've got a backup plan together, because you can probably imagine that you can do a lot of bad stuff if the configuration goes bad, or even if you lose one of the keys that belong to the certificate. Right, so you will generate your certificate, you will generate your key pairs, you will get a certificate issued to you. It's important that store them in a secure way, but need to make sure that you at least have some backup plan. And in this case, the backup pins need to be at least two, I think. And let's say in this case, you would say I would choose a different intermediate authority, right? So a different authority that will be able to issue a certificate for me. in order to make sure that I've got a fallback. So let's say Let Script gets compromised and my web host is Hondi, so I can move to them and I can say it's pinned, you can issue a certificate for me, I can still move on, right? It's good. The other thing, which also is something that you definitely need to do once you start out, there's a report mode that will tell exactly what's happening, right? Because it can break a lot of stuff. It's good first to start in report mode only, and that will show you exactly what the behavior is. And every client that will do the validation will have an endpoint which you will publish that information to, and you can see how, what's inside of it. So just a brief what it looks like. You see the header, right? You see the strict and support security header at the top. And at the bottom, you will see here there are a couple of fingerprints being defined for a certificate and the max age of this. So moving away from this, because a couple of weeks ago, or at least it was in, as far as I can see in the URL, it was in September, somebody published that public key pinning is supposed to be dead. And that has to do with the fact that it's rather complex. You can make big mistakes. And it's good to consider your strategy, what you want to achieve, right? If you're if you're just publicizing some articles that maybe belong to yourself because you have a blog or something, then you should consider maybe not to do pinning or do pinning on a higher level. That will give you less of a risk if something bad goes, if something bad happens, right? But if you're really like an organization that has really a good strategy on how to do the pinning, they will do rotation, they've got every automation in place in order to deal with their certificates, then that's definitely another way to do it, right? So and at DEF CON 24, there were a couple of examples given about like what could go wrong if you have key pinning. First one would be suicide, as to how they call it, you will lose your key pairs. And then you can probably imagine that all the browsers have got the pin in place, and that is stored on the browser. You cannot easily get rid of it. It's installed inside of the browser for the time window that the pin is valid. So those people will be unable to reach out to your website, which is, of course, not a good thing. So always have a backup, make sure that you can regenerate certificates and have control over it. The other one is ransom key pinning. And what happens if somebody has the ability to inject a header inside your web server, he can inject a fingerprint which he owns, like a certificate he owns. And once the current certificate will expire, he will ask ransom for that on you. And he will say, yeah, you will get the private key belonging to this pin if you pay me that amount of money, right? I'm not sure if it's already reported by somebody and if it really happened, but it's a possibility. And the only thing you can do with that is, I'm not sure if you're like familiar with a reverse proxy, but if you've got a web server and if you put another server in front of it, you can eliminate that risk a bit by saying, okay, this header should not be given out by this web server, and that's something that the proxy can help out. So my opinion is, I think this is pinning is good. It is good that you can consider your strategy, what you want. I will have the intermediate pin in place because it's a long living certificate. I believe like Let Script does a 2013 or 2020. Almost more than 10 years, I believe that's the case. So that's good, right? But you still need to be aware that it's an active thing and you need to keep an eye on what's happening. But it will definitely help out on recognizing if somebody uses a rogue certificate or maybe intercepts the communication. So, with that said, this is TLS, right? We've talked about certificates, we've talked about a lot of things about pinning. Cross-site scripting, a concept. I just put in a picture just to at least have a starting point to talk about. Who knows what cross-site scripting is? Everybody. Okay, cool. So, malicious content being injected, executed in the context of the end user, right, in the browser, and it can do a lot of things, right? So that's something, that's the basic thing. And it's still quite prevalent. I believe Wix, that was last week, they had a DOM XSS which was pretty big and it affected all their users. And there was a CA that even got like blind cross-site scripting inside of one of their panels, which is like pretty obscure. Nice article, you should read it. So it's still there, it's still used, right? And some time ago, they defined something which they call content security policies, right? And that's, of course, inside of the browser. You need to define where content originates from in order to do a good job. I think that's the best definition. And the content security policy has got a white list of sources of content, which the browser can accept at that point in that active session of that website. So in case of an injection attack, right? If somebody injects a piece of script, then it comes from another origin that you probably have defined in your whitelist. So therefore, the browser will block it if you don't use the report only mode, right? There is still this is the same as we have seen with the keeping in. You can still do the dry runs with reporting, which is good, right? It will allow you to streamline because this can also still break your site if it's not properly configured, but it will give you enough information to move forward. So it can limit the origin of scripts, images, but it can also restrict on where forms can be posted from your website, which is also good. It can help out on upgrading non-secure communication to secure communication by upgrading the TLS requests. And what you see at the bottom over here is like a small piece. And I'm not going to really show much detail in this. The demo is the last portion of this presentation, but you could probably imagine that this is the default policy you would see at the beginning. And in this case, there was a whitelist defined for images that originate from like the own web server. Scripts can only also like come from the own web server and could be loaded from jQuery.com. And you could probably imagine that if you would define this as a whitelist, then all the scripts that were loaded or can be loaded from jQuery.com are a potential hazard for your website because they still meet up this policy and they can still be loaded at that point, right? So this is the version 1, and in version 2, they took something and moved that forward, right? So they improved it by introducing something they call nounces. And with nounces, the case for script tags, in order to reduce the cross-site scripting risk, you can introduce a random token that you can put inside each of the script tags that the web server renders, meaning that if that nounce is not present in the script tag, it won't be executed by the browser, right? So we see that at the top, right? So the random nouns is a little bit different in content security policy version 2. And the second one will be, okay, we are going to load this script source, and we will do that because the nouns matches the one that was defined, right? And on the website, you've got control over that nouns, so you can do that and lock down the files that are loaded. Still, there was a problem with this because if you load jQuery, it's a single file, maybe from some content delivery network, right? So you're not going to trust the full content delivery network by saying every piece of script can be loaded from this source. No, you want to lock it down. But if you use this nounce, and if internally that script also loads another piece of script, like adding an extra file, that won't work because the internals of that do not have any knowledge of that nounce that need to be part of your script deck, right? And that's the way how you want to define or lock down the policy of the source of JavaScript in order to reduce the risk of cross-site scripting. And that's exactly what I believe two or three guys from Google presented at OPSEC.eu in July. And then I believe later on they did a lot of more conferences. But their research pointed out that 95% of the currently deployed content security policies were broken. So they did not matter at all, right? And be aware that this is not a fix for cross-site scripting. No, this is an addition on doing a good job for cross-site scripting, right? So input validation and encoding of the output is still needed. But this is the extra layer because, yeah, if you program stuff, you will make mistakes and it will still happen, as we have seen with the other examples at the beginning of the cross-site scripting part, right? So therefore, the guy said, okay, we can say complaint. We can say this is bad. But they decided to get involved, and they introduced something which they call strict dynamic. And I think this is the good addition of content security policy, which will definitely get it to work, right? What will happen in this case, this is exactly the same as the nouns we saw earlier. The nouns is loaded, but with strict dynamic keyword, it will then say, okay, once a file is loaded from that content security network or that delivery network that we have seen earlier, then it will trust everything that comes from that single file. And that's exactly what strict dynamic tells. It will say, okay, I now trust implicitly this file, and it can load every file that it needs, right? It will not parse any script, like it will not take any script content from the external and then parse it as JavaScript and execute it. No, it will be allowed to take that second file and load it, which is good. And that will, at least the guys showed in their research, that will definitely make the policy more workable. And I would encourage you to watch their presentation. It's on YouTube. It's good, and they will tell you exactly how content security policy has been created, how it evolved until version 2, and how they now propose version 3, which is the way to go, I think. So once again, this is a mitigating control, so it will reduce the risk of cross-site scripting, but it will not take it fully away. There's a nice post of GitHub, and they will explain exactly how they've done content security policy in their and their services. So it's nice. I think it's a series of blog posts. I definitely encourage you to dig into that. And now we end up with cross-site request forgery, and this is the thing. Now we're going to move to demos, and I'm going to hopefully show you some code and execute it and see how it works. But first question: who knows what cross-site scripting or who knows what cross-site request forgery is? We're going to talk about something different. Okay, so let's briefly go through the concept and see what's happening. Right, so you could probably imagine that if you're using, let's say, your banking website, you log on to their system, you type in your credentials, you maybe need to do something with a random token or something, and once you're active, logged onto that system, you will have a session on that server, right? And that server won't force you to bother like typing your credentials all over again each time. So it will submit the cookie with the session identifier all over again. It will just do that. Hopefully it will do some extra stuff once you're going to transfer money, but in this case, for the example, it doesn't, right? So what will happen is that once a browser will get a URL presented to him, it will just execute it, and the browser is a bit stupid. It will see in this case that it's a pseudo URL that will point out to bank. We're going to transfer an amount of money to an evil account. If that's being presented in a browser that has an active session on the bank and it will be rendered, then it will do that request, right? It will do that request forgery, and it will execute that unwanted transaction for that user. And the user in this case, if it's an image tag and if the programming done on the website is not like really doing something with nonces also on that, right, with tokens, then the execution, then that transaction will be executed and something bad happens, right? So it's an unwanted transactions targeted to the user. The browser is dumb because it will just get a request, it will just execute it, and it will even put the session cookies in because that's the way how it's supposed to be working, and it will then do the request forgery on the server. So a small sidestep, this is request forgeries. If you see the first snippet over here, you see an iframe being loaded, right? And there's a URL being defined, and it looks that it's a router address, and it does an operation, and it will set a DNS server to a specific IP address. If somebody puts this in a website and your router react or is at router.local, you still have the default password, username, password defined. And it has the ability to set the DNS server on your router, and you can probably imagine what happens in that case, right? Because each of the requests will go throughout the malicious router. And I believe with one big ISP in Brazil, this happened during one of the big sporting events over there. Somebody made a lot of money for doing that, right? So it was a targeted attack against the router. In this case, it's also a request forgery. It will say, I'm going to do a set DNS server on this router. And it's the other name will be farming attack. Farming attack. Should I talk a little bit louder? Yeah? The second example, I believe a guy from Google Zero Day, at least Google Zero Project, they do a lot of testing on products. He had one goal to test all the antivirus software, and this is a Trend Micro service that will be installed on your machine, and it will run on localhost on a specific port. And what it will do, it will take a URL and it will execute it. And what's happening in this case, it will do a remote execute of calc.exe, right? So it will just perform any action on your system. If you have got this service running on your server, then this could be injected in a page, and it will do that underneath. You might not even notice that this happened, right? So why does somebody from the internet have the ability to communicate to this endpoint, right? So still, it's also a kind of request forgery. It takes this in account, and it's a local service. And the one at the bottom is the last one I saw, I believe, a month ago. It has to do with Monero, which is also a cryptocurrency. There's a wallet, and it also has an API service running locally. And with this request, if you put this inside of somebody's page that has got that service locally running, it will transfer his money to your account. That's exactly what this will do, right? So these are three different types of request forgeries, and it's all targeted to execute something. And there is Mike West from Google defined a policy, and he thinks that if we can make a distinct between local addresses or private network addresses or internet addresses, we might be able to sort this out, right? So why would somebody from the internet need to have the ability to reach out to your router or reach out to that single service that's running on your machine, right? Aside from the fact that it might be programmed in a bad way and it should not be run, blah, blah, blah. But then there is something within web browsers which is called cross-origin resource sharing. And it will do some sort of pre-flight request. And what it will do is that the browser will first ask the endpoint that if if somebody is allowed to get a resource from it. And in this case, he proposed that, okay, somebody from the internet wants to contact you, and then it will talk to the router, for example, to do this action. Is that allowed or not? And the nice thing about this is that if the browser really enforces it, and the endpoint at the other end, in this case your old router that has got like firmware which won't be updated because the vendor has no interest in doing that, then this won't execute, and the browser will not do that set DNS we saw earlier, which is a good thing, right? So that will mitigate a lot of the risk out of it. The same counts for the other two examples we've seen. Like, why should somebody from the internet have the ability to execute that local service on a specific port which is belonging to Turned Micro? Right, so this is good. I think this is the first step that can eliminate a lot of the farming attacks. And this is a proposal, and I'm not sure in which shape it is. I believe Mike West told that he was working on a concept and he was getting stuff together, so hopefully this will be in. I think this is a change that will reduce a lot of the other risk. Now we're going to do another sidestep and take a look at another type of attack, which sort of is related to request forgeries, but the end and how we're going to fix it will eliminate all of these types of flaws. So, timing and side channels attacks. They've been around for quite some time, and I think the one that's probably mostly known is the blind SQL injection attack, right? So let's say I'm doing a query that's dynamically created on a web server, and I can manipulate all the arguments, but I can't see the output. I can maybe manipulate the time that the query needs to execute in order to have an extra filter to determine if something is A or B, right? And that's exactly what blind SQL injection does. It will maybe introduce a condition and it will say this is true, this is false, and I can exfiltrate data in that way. Another nice example is pixel perfect timing attacks, and that was done by somebody from the UK, I believe, and he presented it at Black Hat. He also did it at UpSec EU, which was held in Hamburg, and he showed that it's easy, or it was like, he eventually connected the dots, and I'm not saying it was easy, but it was a full concept in which he used browser filters as a side channel, right? So within Firefox, there are some effects you can apply in HTML5. And what he did is he could eventually determine if a pixel was black or white. And he did that on the view source of your page. And he had OCR eventually implemented, and he can recognize tokens out of the view source of a page, and he can exfiltrate a lot of data, which was like, at some point I saw him presenting it and I thought, this is mad, how can you connect those dots and make it happen? But these are also timing and side channel attacks to exfiltrate data out of it, right? And this year there was a guy, Tom van Goetem, he's from the KU Leuven, he's a PhD student. He was on a roll. He introduced a lot of side channel attacks, which he also used timing. But the other thing that the others were still lacking is that if you would communicate to a web server, you always have the problem of infrastructure being involved. If I send out a request to a web server, it takes some time and I need to go throughout the internet or a couple of hops between it. And how can you be sure that it does that in a consequent way in order to do your timing attacks if something is A or B, right? It's hard. That will have some effect on the end result. So what he introduced a couple of attacks based on a browser and on the local browser, which were pretty awesome. The first thing is timing attacks I'm going to show you. Then he talked about heist, which you've probably seen on a lot of news sites, which is more targeted to TLS channels, and how to exfiltrate data like that. And the last thing he showed, and I believe last week he even presented another presentation about request and conquer, exposing cross-origin resource sizes. And you can then ask yourself, like, what's possible with this? But this can be quite powerful. So in this case, we see a piece of JavaScript, and this is exactly what the basis is for his timing attacks within the browser. And what he constructed is what's called a promise. So he will say, okay, I will fetch a request, right, which we see at the fifth line. And once that's done, I will start a performance counter. I will put it in the cache. And once that's done, I will stop the performance counter. So you will be in a narrow time window, and it will only be the browser that does that cache storage. And you can probably imagine that for a small file, it will be short. Or a large file, it will be long. And that's exactly the side channel he used for this. And then he showed, like, what can you achieve with that? And what he then did is, like, he created specific Facebook pages for specific ages, genders, and locations. And the same is applicable to LinkedIn and Twitter. But if you have deterministic information inside of a page, and let's say if you're part of a group, you can only access that specific picture, then the size will be bigger than somebody who has not got access to that picture based on his preferences inside of his Facebook profile. So what he eventually was able to do, he could determine your language, he could determine your age, right? It's a privacy concern, and there's a lot of stuff that can, of course, be done based on that, right? same counts then for LinkedIn contact shares and Twitter protected accounts. So what he then did is he took it to the next level. He said, okay, for Black Hat US, he introduced something called Heist. And Heist is almost doing the same thing with a browser, but he only also takes into account that it's a TLS, so it's an encrypted channel. You're not interested in the internals of the data, he's only interested in the size of the data that will allow him to determine if something is true or false. So he found out a way on how to have the windows within the TCP windows that are received and then determine the exact size of a resource. And what he then did is most of the servers apply GSIP on their output. And that's like encryption on the output, which will reduce the size of the page, right? Because they want to have the page loaded as fast as possible. What happens if some input variable is used instead of the output, then that will be optimized, that will be replaced. And that's exactly the difference that allowed him to determine if a specific piece of information was on the page or not. And that's what Heist does. So there's a parameter, let's say you've got a profile page and there's your name. He could then point in, like, I put in NI and then he put in my full name, and then he would see the size of that resource decrease because my name was in that page and therefore the size was decreased and it was replaced with a placeholder. So that's exactly what he did with this, with Heist. So still the basis for this problem is exactly the same as we saw with the router, exactly the same with the time and text we saw earlier. And then at Usenix, he did exactly the same, and then he focused more on browser caching APIs. And it's a bit stupid, because within a browser page, a caching API can take any resource from any website and store it. But you can also set quotas on that cache and the amount of data that gets loaded. So you can probably imagine what he did, like you can fill up the cache and you can exactly determine what the size is of the file that was lastly loaded. So this was his other side channel in which he was able to have that cross-origin resource being distinctive for him enough to determine if something was true or false. Right? So what's the basis of this problem? I explained something at the beginning when we started out with cross-site request forgeries, like there is one basis thing that will be the responsible aspect of this thing, or that will, if we can pull that one out of the equation, this won't work for everything. For anything. So sessions will be stored in your cookie, and your cookie needs to be submitted, right? That's the problem. So what if we disable third-party cookies? Because that's exactly what the problem is, right? So why, if you load an image in any arbitrary page of Facebook, why should that page then also include the Facebook cookie and then have that size being bigger or smaller, right? That's exactly what you want to eliminate. But if you block third-party cookies inside your browser, you should try it once. If you then have a single link to another website, like Facebook will go berserk because it doesn't work, because it has everything tied together in that way. But you cannot do it. You need to log on. You click on the link, it won't recognize the session because it has not submitted the cookie, which is a good thing for privacy, but it's not a good thing for keep it workable, right? And that's exactly the tension field for vendors and changing stuff. So what then was introduced, and I think this is a pretty powerful concept, is called same-site cookies. So with our session, we need to have a cookie inside of our browser available. And with same site, it will be an additional flag that you set on your cookie, which can contain two values. The first one will be lax, and I'm going to show you later on like what it exactly does. And that's strict. Strict will behave exactly in the way that a third-party cookie would do, right? So it won't be submitted if somebody clicks a link that will redirect to your website, then it won't be submitted because it needs to be the same origin. It needs to be something that's initiated from your own website or by the user typing in your URL. The nice thing is already supported by Chrome and by Opera, and there's a nice description on how it's working, what the internals are. And I'm going to show you a demo, and I'm going to show you a couple of examples and show you what we can do with this same site cookie concept. So now the scary apart from switching the monitor, just bear with me. I'm going to duplicate because I want to look at the same screen. So let's pull away the slides. Let's do this. Everybody's able to see this, right? And if there's no answer, I'm considering this that a yes. So let's move on. So what I created is like a simple website, doesn't look fancy, it's the default template, but within that website, there's a person page. And a person page, you need to type in your credentials, right? So Let's type in the credentials that are part of the system. Let's type in right blank password. Could have made it more easy, just give an easy password, but. So it logs on, right? So internally, so there's one single page. It will display a name and it will display an image, right? And this image is exactly is our cross origin resource, right? This is the size. So if I'm opening this one up, if I say log off, if I'm loading that image, it won't load, right? So you need to be in an active session in order to expose that resource and be successful with that. So there is another option. There's another operation with this. So within the person page, there's an ability to update a name. And this is the most simple request forgery attack that you can see, right? This is a simple URL, and this will take the input of the end user. In this case, it's the name Finn, and it will update it. So once I press enter, you will see the name will be displayed. It's part of this profile, right? So this will be our basis for this demo. Let's move on. Let me quickly check one thing before I'm moving out. Yes, is my internet still there? So this is a page which is external. It runs on a different site, it runs on a different server. It loads the image. If we see the source of this, we will see that it will load the image, right? That's the first thing. Maybe zoom in a bit, and then below that there's a link. Nothing fancy. We'll also increase the image. Nice. Click on the link, it will continue to be there, right? So this is exactly the page that might be malicious, that will load our content, and that will determine if the picture is big or small, and therefore if we're logged on to the website, for example. If we then take a quick look and introduce an intercepting proxy, then we can exactly see what was the thing that I was forgetting. Let me see if this works. This is intercepting. So you see, I'm going to turn the sequence around, so the newest one will always be on top. We see that this loads the page, and in the response, it will say nothing changed. But if we then see, it will then load the image. And in that image, that is the identity application with a lot of gibberish behind it. But this is the session cookie of ASP.NET, which you'll get by default if you install it. Right, so if we then move back, and let's alter something. So let's say if we're malicious, and let's say we're doing not nice things, and we're going to say we're going to update the name, you will see that it can be done putting in the name. It will load. If we now open up the person page once more, it should be there, right? So this is something that might be loaded. You don't notice it. It will execute it on the side. So this is the basic demo, and this is the basic thing that we're going to protect with same site cookies. That's exactly what I'm going to do right now. Let me quickly change something. So I'm not sure if somebody of you is doing .NET development and want to have the code, I'm willing to share it later on. I'm also planning on publishing it in NuGet to be available for everybody to use, because it will just use the default ASP.NET identity provider, and it will just replace the cookie management with another implementation which will have the extra attribute inside. Now it needs to build. It might fail because of the .NET core stuff that locks a specific file. I think this is looking good. I think it still has got a session previously, so let me log out for that once more. And then do the logon, and let's see what has been changed in the cookie, and then see the demo page, and then see what kind of effects it has on the session. There's no proxy waiting. Nope. Cool. Okay, this is already done. So let's log on. Mr. Stormtrooper. It has been compiled, so it needs to load. It's typing the password. Hopefully a good one. Mental note, next time put in an easy password. It's loading. Yours. So if we now quickly go and see the login request we've done, we will see in the response, hopefully visual to everybody, but there's an additional attribute. This is the identity cookie we saw earlier, and at the end you will see that there's the same site lax. And lax means that it will not be as restrictive as a real third-party cookie. It will be sent if you click on a link, and it won't force you to log on. So then the session identifier will be sent out, and that's exactly that. I think that's the behavior that a lot of systems just need in order to be usable, and also eliminate the risk of the request forgery. So let's now go back to our demo site, and let's see what happened right now. So this is loading the image, and the loading image will fail. Because if we see internal, if we see the request under the hood, then we will see that it will try to get the image, and it will say, yeah, I'm not sure if you can read it, but it says that it's not found and you need to go to the logon page. You're not an active user at this point, right? So of course that will tell something about somebody, but it doesn't give that significant, like the real picture. If you've got a profile picture, it probably will be unique for a user, right? So that will give you enough information, or at least information to start working from. So let's see if we do exactly the same which we saw earlier by replacing the image. And let's do the update name once more based on the image tag, right? So that's the simple cross-site request forgery attack. Let's put in my own name. It's supposed to be having Nout, and I'm saying please update it to Niels. If we see the proxy underneath, it will tell us right now exactly like, hey, it's not found, it has not executed. If we go back to the page and if we load the person, you will still see that now it is still being mentioned as the name. Nothing changed, right? So we mitigated that first class request forgery attack, which is almost the simplest one because it's that single URL, right? It's just that single URL that everybody can embed in a page. I think this is quite powerful if you have just a lax cookie in place, and this can be used for most of the session cookies you're using already inside your application, so you're developing right now. So, but now let's take the link. Let's quickly copy paste the URL we put in inside the image, but let's now replace it with the link. There's one downside with lax cookies, because if you put this in the link, you will see, I think it will redirect, it will update it, right? So this is still causing a problem of request forgeries, right? There are still scenarios being available for the attacker to maybe do that request forgery, aside from the fact like that URL, that get request should be rewritten, it should be a post, it should be a token. If you do that in combination with this, then you're definitely at the safer side. So let's see, how can we deal with this? And I think the most power can be get from doing two cookies, one with the lax value that contains the session, and one with the strict value that will be used in order to allow the browser to tell, like, hey, this is an action that was executed by the browser, that was done by the end user, right? That strict cookie is that real third-party cookie, and it will only be done if somebody initiates that request from the same origin. So let's introduce that, and I made some changes on this. You will see. This build, it should at least fail once. I've seen it all the time when I was preparing, like, unable to compile. Oh, it's being polite. Then something else needs to go wrong after this. I think there's still an active session. So first, let's quickly log on, see what the differences are in the request, and then see what kind of effect that has. Right, so the concern lies in the fact that if there's a link and somebody can click on it, then it's still that request forgery that we want to at least mitigate. Let me log off. I'm going to quickly show you. Then I'm going to conclude. It's already done. So what I've done is that this request will produce two cookies, and it will do an additional cookie. And in this case, it's just a flag cookie. It will just have a value. It has no internal value of its own. like for the real implementation, you should probably do a bit more. But if we see over here, we see that there's the lax cookie, that's this one, and there's a strict cookie, which is the second one. And that's nice, and I forgot to do one more thing, because the previous one was like using the application's default, and there's no changes that need to be done. And then for this, you need to change a bit of code, because we want to make sure that we're doing the strict request, and that's something that you can just check in your code, right? So the session will be provided, the code will be executed, the session will be reconstructed, the user identity is there. And then in this case, I will just do the additional check by saying I want to have the strict cookie also available. Otherwise, unauthorized, right? So you don't need to understand the full code, but it's just the additional logic that we need in order to determine if something is a request that's done by an end user or on a different way. So let's execute it once more. And for the sake of time, going to quickly just show you that link thing is not working anymore because it's lacking that strict cookie that we need. And I also put it on that image request, but that's technically even not necessary because that lax is already enough to not expose that origin. Come on, once more. If you want to speed up. Come on. That's not the right one. This is. So while it's creating our session, hopefully with the right password, there it is. So if you now open up to the other page that we saw earlier, we will see that the image will still fail loading. We reconstructed that image link by putting this in. Let's say this is with strict, make it that in strict, something else. If we click on this, then you will see that the page produces an unauthorized. It will still have a session, but it won't execute this action. If I then go back to the current session of the user, then you will see that the name is not updated. So this is exactly what you want, right? So with that lax cookie, you will have the control over at least the session cookie being submitted once a user wants to interact with you, right? So not with all the image loading, that's good. And the strict cookie will give you more control if non-read-only action needs to be executed. I think that should be the pattern. Okay, so let's quickly go back to the slides before I'm out of time. I think I'm already. Okay, so my conclusion. First of all, of course, it's important to always fix code, right? And write good software. So cross-site scripting needs to be remediated by doing input validation and doing output encoding. But the things that I've shown you today should all be an addition to it, right? So TLS, if you're doing that in combination with maybe the strict transport security and also some pinning. If you have the ability to do content security policies, it's good. And then same site cookies, as I mentioned, I think that's quite powerful. That will eliminate a lot of risks and a lot of problems we have with request forgeries. I definitely encourage you to dig into the three presentations I've put out at the bottom. Right, there's Tom. If you search on his timing attacks, you will find a lot more. Mike West from Google, and then the other guys from Google talking about CSP. And making CSP great again. So that wraps it up. These are the other resources, the same. Any questions? And if it remains silent, then I'm going to say, oh, sorry, yeah?
Then I have one.
Yeah.
The code change you made to the page,
yeah.
Is that specific to test the additional cookie?
It's
and if you would have made the regular session cookie strict, that would not have been necessary?
That would not have been necessary, but then you force the user to log on each of the requests if you click on a link, right? So it will be more of a pain for the end user to go to your site. So that's the difference, right? Because the lax cookie will be submitted if a top-level request inside your browser is done. So if somebody clicks on a link, and that's still workable, right? So that will smoothen the pain, by not having fully third-party cookie blocked, but then only the session will be created at that point, which is good, right? And then a strict thing is extra logic to validate, and that's something that you control, and it's nice that the browser exposes that it will tell you, like, hey, this is a request that's done in the context of our origin, right? So you can trust it. I think that's quite good, and that will have some extra logic needed. That's a necessity. Anybody else? Yeah.
I think it's so important to validate input like a return URL parameter in your parameter.
Yeah. Yeah. Input validation is always basic. Like strategy one will be input validation. Open redirects can still be harmful for a lot of other things. Content security policies also suffered from that. If there's one open redirect on one of the things that you trust, then you're also lost because everybody can still inject throughout that, which makes it hard, right? I believe at the presentation with Object, they asked like who has done CSP in production and was successful with it. And there were like two or three hands in the audience, like a room full of people. So it's hard. But the same goes for, coding practices in general. It's important to make sure that you do input validation and output and coding for the right context, for sure.
Yes, because I guess this one was still broken.
I think this, from code perspective, it's still broken. You need to fix it, right? But I'm just showing out, like, there is more stuff in the browser available that will help us do a better job and have an extra layer of protection. Because if you program, you make mistakes, right? That's awesome. Okay, thanks.